Salut tout le monde, bienvenue à Football Therapy avec moi, Yann. How you doing? I hope you're doing well, man. I really do hope that. Welcome to Football Therapy, that's what I said. By the way, and welcome to Chelsea News, the daily series here on Football Therapy, where I go across football news media, consolidate some interesting stuff regarding Chelsea Football Club, presented to you right there, sitting here, there, watching this, the viewer. Let you know my opinion on the stories, and more importantly, ask for yours, and hopefully get them down in the comment section below. And today we are talking about three stories. All three stories, or subject matter today, is coming from The Athletic, a superb collection of football writing. I'm not sponsored by The Athletic, but you should go check it out, because it's an excellent source of football writing. Simon Johnson wrote an excellent piece on Michy Batshuayi. I want to talk about the Belgian striker's current status at Chelsea Football Club. Chelsea are trying to sell him. What's going to happen with him? A little bit of talk on Michy Batshuayi. Liam Toomey did an excellent piece on Jorginho. Chelsea's Jorginho or Sarri's Jorginho? What is happening with Jorginho? Let's talk about him a little bit too. And German bad man Raphael Honigstein has talked about Kai Havertz, the hot topic in European football. It's a really great long article, but I'm only going to talk about a little bit referring to Chelsea and Bayern Munich, which I found interesting. So, lots to get into today, so buckle yourselves in, boys and girls, and a quick reminder to subscribe to this channel if you haven't done so already. Hey, only if you want to, but if you choose to sub, please do hit the bell notifications icon. And if you want to support your boy Yan, please do like this video. All right then, let's get into it. Let's start off with the Brazilian-Italian Jorginho, son of Sarri. Jorginho had a very difficult time at Chelsea. He started off well. Chelsea fans saw him as the sort of technician he was, but he dropped out of favour with the Chelsea fan base. People started booing him. He basically came into some adversity. Everyone saw him as an easy target, as Sarri's sort of general on the pitch when Sarri wasn't doing too well with the Chelsea fans, and he basically got to a speed bump in his Chelsea career. I'm not going to go through it all, but long story short, Jorginho won the fans over, whether it was converting penalties, getting aggressive, getting stuck in. He basically started playing like a leader on the pitch. He won over Stamford Bridge, and before long, the Chelsea faithful were singing his name. Jorginho! Not the most creative chant, but still, it's a way they showed their affection. Jorginho was humbled by this turnaround, by this success story, and he is seemingly very, very happy at Chelsea Football Club. In Liam Toomey's article, he speaks about when Jorginho talked about Sarri. Jorginho always insisted that his relationship with Sarri was no closer than you would expect from any player and his coach. Quote, I don't go out for dinner with him, I don't go around his house, end quote, he said in an interview with The Guardian in March 2019. Our work is very professional, and he speaks and explains what he wants me to do, and I try to understand that and do my best for the team, end quote. Pretty much saying, look mate, he's not my dad, stop bullying me, I'm just like all the rest of you. Liam goes on in this article to talk about Sarri and his current situation with Juventus at the Old Lady, trying to win the Scudetto, and he's on for that, but it's not been an easy ride. Bringing a Sarri ball to Turin was not smooth. He's been playing Pjanic in that regista role, and it's not really happening. You could see why he would want to bring Jorginho in, just to drop him in for an easy transition to help his football move forward. Now, it's been reported in this article that Chelsea have opened talks with Juventus for potential dealings this summer, but you know, the likes of swap deals were coming up. Chelsea's done long negotiations with Juventus before for the likes of Alexandro, or at least talking about him for a long, long time, and of course Gonzalo Higuain. So there's a relationship there, and there have been recent talks to try and get some business done, but to be honest, the way Jorginho is talking about Chelsea and how positive he's looking on the training pitch, I think it's far, far away from any deal getting done. But don't write it off, because, you know, anything can happen. The transfer market is crazy. But Jorginho, as things stand, is very happy at Chelsea. Right, before we talk about Raphael Honigstein's story on Kai Havertz, or the bits that I'm interested in anyway, let's move on and talk about Simon Johnston's piece in The Athletic about Michy Batshuayi. Simon starts this piece with, the camera never lies. With arms folded, a stern expression on his face, Michy Batshuayi looks like he has well and truly got the message regarding his future at Chelsea. A picture posted in the club's official website and app last weekend of an in-house game between the squad members at Stamford Bridge captured Batshuayi in a somber mood. So he's looking unhappy off the bat, and you can kind of understand why if he's not being involved. This photo, taken as Lampard addressed both teams, showed Batshuayi as one of only two players among the group without a shirt number. Him and the other one was Academy graduate Armando Broja. Yeah. A club insider told The Athletic that Batshuayi only came on for the last third of the match to not make the starting 11 for either side in a Chelsea versus Chelsea game is clearly a very worrying sign. His prospects looked even grimmer after the club sources confirmed he did not play at all in the friendly when Reading came to Cobham training ground on Wednesday. Didn't play at all in the Reading game. That is really bad, man. Chelsea are obviously trying to flog him. They're probably not wanting to get him injured, because if you get injured in like a friendly before the window opens, I kind of get that. But yeah, it's looking pretty bleak for Michy at this point, man. Simon goes on to explain in this article, for most of the campaign, Michy Batshuayi was actually ahead of Giroud in the pecking order, 24 appearances to Giroud's 13, but that all changed following a disappointing performance against Manchester United 4 months ago in the absence of injured Abraham. Giroud started the next five matches while Abraham recovered from an ankle problem, and the last fixture Chelsea played against Everton, Broja came on instead of fellow substitute Batshuayi for what was the 18-year-old's senior debut. Right, so when the teenage prodigy is ahead of you and you're a Belgium international, you know your time is up at Chelsea Football Club. We kind of knew that when that game happened, when Broja came on, but what Simon's saying from behind the scenes, what's happening on the training pitch, it does sound like Batshuayi is definitely the striker to be sold amongst the rest of them. Batshuayi obviously had a loan spell at Palace, and they were interested in buying Batshuayi after his loan spell, which they paid a £1 million loan fee, but Chelsea did not sell him to Palace, who were interested and willing to buy at the time, because Chelsea had a transfer ban and they could not afford to let another striker go. It wasn't just Palace that were interested in buying Batshuayi after a loan spell. He had a very successful loan in Germany playing for Dortmund, obviously a massive club, actually playing with Christian Pulisic at the time. He scored 9 goals in just 14 apps with a very good minutes per goal ratio return. Dortmund were very interested in buying Michy Batshuayi, but were immediately repelled by Chelsea's quoted figure, £50 million. I mean, at the time, you know, he's in his prime, scoring a lot of goals, looking very good. I could understand how Chelsea would see a high value for him, but starting at £50 million, and Chelsea don't low sell, they never sell low. Dortmund are not in the business of losing money, they make money with transfers. So that didn't happen. The Athletic understand that Palace are no longer interested in Michy Batshuayi because they can't afford him. So Chelsea are left in a very tight spot. They're going to have to make a loss on him from what they originally bought him for, and they'll probably end up selling him to Ligue 1, to a club in Liga. Anyway, he'll always have certain good memories at Chelsea, and Chelsea fans will fondly remember him for little moments, whether it be the goal against West Brom that won Chelsea the league, or the goal against Ajax this season, or perhaps the goal away in the Wanda Metropolitano against Atletico Madrid, where Chelsea won 2-1, the first team to beat Madrid in their new stadium. So, you know, he's also scored a hat-trick for Chelsea in like a cup or something. He had a good time. Anyway, let's move on from Michy Batshuayi and let's talk about Raphael Honigstein's story on Kai Havertz. Obviously, Kai Havertz is a hot topic around European football. He's very, very young, he's very talented, and most uniquely in many ways, he is very, very versatile positionally and plays as an accomplished player in many spots on the pitch. In this article, Raphael Honigstein talks about the story of Havertz a little bit more, which I'm not going to get into. We all know he's an excellent player, and in this video, in this segment, I just want to talk about the excellent player. Honigstein talks about the players' representatives have been fielding inquiries from all over Europe's top clubs over the past 18 months, which is why every story you read linking him with Bayern Munich, Real Madrid, Barcelona, Liverpool, Manchester United, and Chelsea all has a basis in truth. Basically, yeah, the last two seasons, Kai Havertz has been amazing, and all the top clubs around Europe have been making inquiries about him. Reports that Chelsea have shown a renewed interest are accurate. Due to the sheer number of potential takers and buyers intransigence, it would be wrong to suggest that Chelsea are somehow in the lead of this race. The Athletic was told by a source close to Chelsea that the Premier League club, Leverkusen, and Havertz are currently miles apart, end quote, in terms of striking a potential deal. Basically insinuating, yes, loads of clubs are interested, yes, there's a basis of truth in all of it, including Chelsea, really looking closely at the player, but no one is close to the player at the moment. Now, this next part is what I find interesting, because the bookmakers make Bayern Munich favourites to join Kai Havertz. And I've said recently in these videos, I just get this feeling that he'll end up at Bayern. But Honigstein goes on to say this: Bayern are no closer. They are concentrating their efforts on signing Leroy Sané from Manchester City this summer, and there's only an outside chance that they're willing or able to commit the best part of 150 million euros, fee and wages, on Havertz's capture. Signing a right back is higher on their list of priorities. Right, so there's the interesting part for me. They're more interested in signing a right back than Kai Havertz, so we know they've got a long-term priority of sealing the deal of Leroy Sané. Ah, interesting. Leroy Sané is their preference now. Kai Havertz is going into his last year, I believe? I hope I'm right about that. So if Bayern Munich have other preferences like Leroy Sané, could Leroy Sané pave the way for Kai Havertz to come to Stamford Bridge? Maybe. Sané really, really wants Bayern Munich. We've known that. He's wanted it for a long time. Bayern Munich really, really want Leroy Sané. Imagine Sané, Gnabry, Lewandowski. Just superb. And I think Leroy Sané would be a lot cheaper than Kai Havertz. Maybe not a lot cheaper, but City probably know they need to sell him, or could sell him, and probably get away with not playing him, because City have been excellent without Sané. So they might be able to sell him for, I don't know, 20, 30 million less than Havertz. But Sané is more of a priority for Bayern. Hell, a right back is more of a priority than Havertz for Bayern. So that's really good news. I'm not saying Chelsea are now favourites, but no one is. But I thought Bayern might have been the super favourites, but this is kind of good news to me, and I found that super interesting. Anyway, what do you lot think? Give me your comments, thoughts down in the comment section below. If you've enjoyed the video that I've provided for you guys today, please do consider liking this content, and of course, subscribe to the channel if you haven't done so already. My brain's starting to malfunction, so it's probably time I end the video. Feel free also to follow me on social media at FootballYannick on both Instagram and Twitter. That's it from me, you lot. Enjoy the football that is starting soon, and I will see you later. Way so tough with that bad boy tuck. I'ma get it how I'm living, I'ma walk the walk. Outline my lines, I rap through thought. Body bag the verse, outline the chalk. In my life seen trouble, hustle on the double. Silence on the trigger like my pick got a muzzle. Yo chick like to guzzle, bad boy stay in trouble. I only love this paper, sorry I don't. I love me, baby.